So a function component is, well, originally people referred to them as stateless components because, well, they couldn't have state associated with them. And that's because, as you pointed out, you don't have a this context. So there was no way to do that sort of tracking. So for a long time, you kind of relied on class-based components as a way to manage state, and then function components maybe as a way to just render out just the data that was changed in there. But, well, not all components are going to want to have, or not all applications are going to want to have class-based components. So the React team introduced this concept of hooks. Hooks are a way to introduce state into a function component. Now, hooks only work with function components. They don't work with class-based components, and they allow you to do all the things that we want to do with a application that uses state, but purely from a function one, a function component. So let's pick a different example that we've got here. Maybe let's use this one, this markdown renderer that we've got, and let's turn. Whoop, if I don't scroll up too far, where there we are. There we go. So this is a class-based component. But let's look at how we could turn this into maybe a function component. So we're going to create a new, we'll come down and create a new one. Ah, it's really going to be tedious that it's bouncing around like that. But we'll do const markdown editor 2 because naming things is super hard.
I'm very creative when
And
I name things for on the fly demos.
yeah. And we let's just grab all of this, this return statement. Pop that in here. It's gonna really bother me that things aren't indenting properly, but I will get over it. Okay, so ta-da, we've made things not work. That's probably not ideal, but let's make them properly work.
That
So we're gonna need to
that's my
look at how.
superpower is making things not work.
Exactly. So how are we gonna deal with things like, well, a text editor. Sorry, text area. It's an editor, but yeah, it's the text area. And we're also going to need to have some way that we can render out this raw markup. Let's start with, well, what's the value going to be for this text area? So it provides a default value and it's getting this dot state. Well, we know that that doesn't work. So we can use hooks. And this is where I'm going to find out whether or not the editor experience that we've got here is going to support hooks, or we'll quickly segue to some other way to get hooks. Maybe I'll pop over to the console here and see if I get any error messages. I'm getting lots. Good start.
I think it might just be because you don't have this at the moment.
Yeah, I think that's probably where a lot of it's going to be. Okay, so we are going to do const, what do we've got? The text. And then we'll go set text. I'll explain what all of this is doing in a moment. If, where did my cursor go? Text is going to be equal to react.useState. And there we go. Okay. And then we're going to need to have like a handle change function. But let's just comment some of this stuff out. Comment. There we go. And
Just gonna slide
we'll
the
need
screen over
to.
switch here to make it a little. There we go.
Okay, now we've got rid of all of our red errors, and successfully we have created an input field. I can type some stuff in there, but well, is it going to do anything with that value? Well, we'd kind of like it to ultimately render that as markup, so I'd like to be able to go hello and world, because hello world is the only thing that we know how to do. But I need to tell React that as this value is changing, that it needs to be aware of it. Now, in our class-based component, we had this unchanged handler. So, well, because Re React is immutable, so we need to do something to tell React that the value of that input has changed, and the value of our text here is changed. So, first off, let's set the start value to be text, and now we'll type in. Awesome. So I can still type in. It doesn't know that that value has changed. So our on change, we're going to then add a custom handler, which will take the event. And I'm going to do this in line rather than creating separate functions, mostly from laziness standpoint. And if we went, say, console.log e.target.value, Well, at least I think it's value. Yeah, it's e.target.value. And we'll bring up our dev tools again, clear out the console, scroll back down. We can see very faintly as I type in, we go, hello, world.
Okay.
So that function is being executed every time I'm doing a key press. So like the value of that text editor is changing.
So that unchanged, that's not something that's special to React. That's just a, that's just part of text area. That's just the normal text area event. Yes. Every time you change it, that's now being raised. And so right now you're just printing that out. Okay.
Yep. So if I was to come over, I'm going to have some React dev tools. There we go. I was amazed that worked. I couldn't see any icons there. Let's see if I can find this component. Here we go. So Markdown Editor 2. Now, it's aware that it's got some state, and that state is currently not set to anything. Instead of doing console.log, we're going to do set text.
And that set text comes from up above.
Yes. Okay. So we'll come back to what that's doing in a moment.
Okay.
And we go, hello, world. And if we find this component again, now we'll see that state has been updated to hello world. Excellent. That's what we want, because we're going to need to then render that out later. So how did all of that work? Well, with React hooks, we have a number of different hooks, and the one I'm using here is use state. So React hooks all start with this, with use as a keyword, because that's the convention that they've got. So it's use state, use effect, and so on and so forth. So use state allows us to create some state for a function component. We give it a default value, which is, I'm just defaulting it to an empty string. And then the return of that is an array that has two arguments. The first argument is going to be the current state. The second argument is a state mutation function. So you can name those whatever you want to name them. In this case, I'm calling it text and set text, but there's no reason that I couldn't call this Jane and then set Jane. Like it doesn't matter what they're called. You call them what is relevant for your application. So we'll call them text and set text because that's representing this bit of state. Now, I could also have as many bits of state as I want. I could have const foo and set foo. And then this is React use state. And this could be a number. And then I could update that as a number. It could be an object that has text and that has an empty string there. So initially, instead of doing text, we could do foo.text. So, and like I said, you can have as many of these as you want. Now, the last thing we're going to need to do is, well, how do we render this markdown out? At the moment, well, I need to do something that will render it out. So we use, because I need to generate some HTML that's going to render out, we use this dangerously set in a HTML, just because React is trying to be really careful about not just arbitrarily injecting HTML, because that's an avenue for cross-site scripting or XSS attacks. So we have to be really explicit. Like, I know I'm aware that I'm just arbitrarily adding HTML that you have no concept of or control over, and I'm trusting that the HTML I'm injecting is going to be fine. So I need to, well, how do I generate this markdown? I could write another function that we pass stuff through, or I could add some more state that's actually going to have that. So let's do some more state, const, and then we'll call it markdown and set markdown. And this will be React use state. And that's going to also start off as an empty string because we don't have any markdown initially. And then here we will do double underscore HTML, and that will be markdown. That's how we render out, at least that's how I think we render it out. Let me just double check up here. Yes. And have I got all of my squigglies correct? Excellent. And I'm getting a warning about something on some line somewhere. There it is. Who on the stream saw the bug before I did?
Nobody yet, but I'm like furiously trying to go through all the comments here. There's a lot of questions and comments, which is fantastic. Okay, so awesome. So now you've got that. Now you've got that working. So now you can put in the input in Markdown, and now that will properly display out.
Well, so I can type in something here. Hello world.
Uh-oh. Okay,
but I need to do something that's going to convert that into Markdown.
Right.
The way they use this. So in the class-based example, we had this generate raw markdown or raw markup, which was then using a library called Remarkable, which they were setting to like a bunch of. I can't do any of that sort of thing. So let's instead pretend that we've been provided markdown, the markdown renderer as a argument that's been passed in. So then we can go MD equals new remarkable. I think it was called remarkable. So that's going to be passed in correctly. And we're going to introduce another hook. I'm going to use the React use effect hook. So use effect is when I want to do something that is the side effect of a hook that's changed, a state value that's changed. So what I need to do with the effect is I need to tell it what are the bits of state that could change that you need to be aware of. So it's going to be text, and it's also the markdown. It's also props that I might be dependent on. So these are things that could result in this effect running. So whenever text changes, run this effect. And we're going to then do, inside of this, we'll do set markdown to the result of MD dot, let's actually have a look at how we do it. MD dot render, render text. So now I can hopefully go, hello world. And we've got our markdown working. And that's all happening with hooks.